wonderful counselor, holy one.
Bread of life, Savior, Redeemer.
You are
wonderful counselor, holy one.
Jehovah Jireh Elohim.
You are
high priest and heir to all living.
Jehovah Jireh Elohim.
You are
highest priest, heir of all living things. Famous God of the world and the earth.
You are
King of kings but of true royalty.
To worship this morning. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord, but I was glad because we've had another trying week, another disaster after disaster, and then the passing of the longest reigning monarch in history. But the thing that we're glad about today is that our God reigns. Our God reigns, kingdoms, as that song said, kings and kingdoms, they will all pass away. But our God reigns, and he lives, and he reigns forever. We thank the Lord for this great opportunity to come and worship this morning. I am glad to be in the house of the Lord our God. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. And so we ask in the name of Jesus that you come and go with me this morning. Come and go with me in spirit to our Father's house, where we can praise God, where we can worship the Lord, where we can anticipate the inevitable supernatural intervention of God, because he reigns and he reigns forevermore. Our God reigns. Let us go into the house of the Lord. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within our gates, O Jerusalem, for a day in thy courts is better than 1,000. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the sake of the house of the Lord, our God, I will seek thy good. Those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. O Lord, I have loved the house in which you dwell, the place where your glory abides. But the Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord. You are our rock and our redeemer. Oh, sing unto the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have given him victory. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises.
Jesus, there is something about that name. Kings and kings shall pass away, but there is something about that name. It is that name, that name that's above every name, that every knee will bow down to, and every tongue will confess to. Let us bow our heads and offer up our prayers to the Lord. Our Father and our God, who art in heaven, glory be to your name. We come this morning thanking you, Lord, again for your amazing presence in this place this morning. We come praying, dear Lord, that your glory fills this place this morning. We come, oh Heavenly Father, thanking you for you just extending your grace and your mercy to us so that we can partake of the many, many blessings, oh Heavenly Father, that we have received. We come this morning, O Heavenly Father, with our hearts and minds that are ready to hear a word from you this morning, Lord. We come, O Heavenly Father, praying, dear Lord, that your Holy Spirit will be manifested in this place, O Heavenly Father. We come this morning asking, dear Lord, that you touch every heart of every person assembled here this morning, Lord, so that we will get ready, O Heavenly Father, to hear a word, O Heavenly Father, that's going to make the difference, O Heavenly Father, in our lives and in every lives and every person, O Heavenly Father, that have come this morning. We pray, O Heavenly Father, that every need from every person, dear Lord, be met, O Heavenly Father, and that your name will be praised for all. We know, O Heavenly Father, exactly what each person stands in need of the Lord. So we asking, O Heavenly Father, that whatever it be, O Heavenly Father, that you extend it to them, Lord. You know, O Heavenly Father, that some of us come with heavy hearts, O Heavenly Father. We ask, Lord, that you give them a word, O Heavenly Father, this morning, so that their hearts will be touched, O Heavenly Father, and makes a difference in their life. We pray, O Heavenly Father, that minds, O Heavenly Father, will be touched, O Lord, because we know that there is a lot of mental illness, O Heavenly Father, that's going on, emotional stress, O Heavenly Father, that burdens us down, O Heavenly Father. So we come this morning asking that you touch our minds, O Heavenly Father, and put us in a better place so that we all know that you are still the true and living God, the God, O Heavenly Father, that is always there to help us and lift us up out of any and every pit, O Heavenly Father. We pray, O Heavenly Father, that you touch our pastor this morning, O Heavenly Father. We pray, O Heavenly Father, for your anointing power, O Lord. We pray that you touch him, Lord, from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet, O Heavenly Father, so that every word, O Heavenly Father, that you have given him is preached, O Heavenly Father, that is preached, O Heavenly Father, with power and authority. We thank you, dear Lord, and we just can't praise you enough, because you are the God that's always extending your mercy and your grace to us. So we ask right now in the name of Jesus that you allow your Holy Spirit to enter and fill this space. Touch, O Heavenly Father, every person that is assembled this morning. Prepare us, O Heavenly Father, the way that you have never prepared us before, because we need, O Heavenly Father, that special filling, O Heavenly Father, so that your Holy Spirit lives and abides within our very soul. Help us, O Heavenly Father, in any way that you see fit, dear Lord, because you know exactly what we send and need for, Lord. So we ask, dear Lord, right now that you prepare every person in this place. If anything, O Heavenly Father, has entered in that is not about you, we ask, O Heavenly Father, that you just get rid of it, O Heavenly Father, because we are about worship this morning. We are about praise this morning. And that is just what we are going to do. So we thank you, O Heavenly Father. And we just, we pray, O Heavenly Father, that your holy will is done this morning. We pray that in the name of Jesus, that you will be magnified and that the Father be glorified in this place in right now, in the name of Jesus. Amen, amen, and amen.
to give him praise. I came to give him love. Say, I don't know what you come to do.
I don't know what you come to do.
Say, I don't know what you come to do. To clap my hands, I came to do my dance.
My dance.
I came to give him joy.
My voice.
I came to make some noise.
Some noise.
To our Sunday service. On behalf of our senior pastor, Reverend Dr. Gerald Folsom, and First Lady Joyce Folsom, we are so grateful you are here, whether in person or in our virtual sanctuary. We are good ground to sow a seed. Hemaway is always ready to serve and meet the needs of the community. From our coat drives, backpack giveaways, food for our seniors, prayer and gift cards at the grocery store, our angel tree to support children who have incarcerated parents, baby diaper drives, and so much more. To give, visit us on our website at HemingwayMemorialAME.org/give. This includes using the Givelify app, searching for Hemingway Memorial AME, or PayPal using the links provided. We also have Cash App, $Hemingway Memorial. You can send a check made payable to the church, mailing it to 6330 Gateway Boulevard, District Heights, Maryland, 20747. If you are in the area, please feel free to bring your donation to our drop box on the Blazer Drive side of the church. For those of you in the physical sanctuary, you can drop your offering in any one of the boxes along the walls.
Something I've never seen.
The Second Episcopal District has put out a call for each of us to join or renew our membership with the NAACP. As a member, you'll make a difference each and every day in this fight and become a part of a vibrant community of people who stand for justice and equality. We need you to act now by going to naacp.org/membership. please do this by October. The link is also available on our website. Our Bible studies are back. You are always invited to join us during the week. There is something for everyone, from the Blueprint for Young Adults, Wednesday Prayer Call, Noonday and Pastor's Bible Study, ending with Men's Bible Study and Word on the Street for the Youth. Visit our website for information on how to join us virtually. Mark your calendars now. Our next quarterly conference with Presiding Elder Assembly will be held via Zoom on Tuesday, September 20th at 7:15 p.m. Zoom details will be shared soon. Please be aware of the Capital District Conference that will be held at Reed Temple AME in Glendale, Maryland from October 20th to 22nd. Details forthcoming. Whether you are a first-time visitor or a seasoned member, we invite you to visit our website at www.hemingwaymemorialame.org. You'll find service times, ministry events, new members orientation and the handbook, options to give, worship experiences both live and on demand, current ministries and how to get involved, a calendar of meetings and events, the membership portal to check your account and access all forms, a press portfolio, and a way to contact us with questions, concerns, and prayer requests. I'm getting ready.
All over my life.
All over my life.
All more time, and I see the promises are fulfilled. Come on, go.
And I see the promises are fulfilled.
I'm a direct, here we go.
All over my life. All over my life.
Oh, come on, give God a hand clap of praise and give him glory and give him honor. If you feel the promises of God still on your life, if you've been on the battlefield for the Lord, if you're still on the battlefield for the Lord, give God some praise and give him glory and give him honor. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't know about you. I can even say in my small, short lifespan, I ain't always been fully on the battlefield, but I thank God that God never gave up on me. And I had some folks praying for me. And so he put me back on the battlefield. I don't know about you, but that's my testimony. Some of y'all been on the battlefield a lot longer than me. Hang on in there. Keep holding up the bloodstained banner. God is still in the blessing business. God is still the one that has to move everything forward. God is still the one that went well beyond time and set everything in order. God is still the one, and God is still the one that's going to have to show us all how to reimagine ministry after the pandemic. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's still in control. Thank you, God. Oh, thank you for blessing us. Thank you for just waking us up this morning. If you got a thank you on your heart, thank you for the life of Sister Maggie Williams. Thank you, God, for Brother James Furtis still going. We already believe he's healed. Thank you for others in our congregation that we may not know of that are going through some battles in their body, and we already believe by his stripes are healed. If you got a thank you praise on your heart this morning, you ought to go on, take about 15 seconds. Just, I know we are muted up, but you can just give God praise the way you want to. You can just say hallelujah to him. You can just say thank you to however you want to. You want to give him praise and give him glory. You might just have a thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you for Hemingway. Thank you for the committed people of Hemingway. Thank you for the loving hearts at our church. Thank you for what you're doing here. Thank you that we may not always understand it all, but you're working it all together for your good, God. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. 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 Glory. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you have your Bible or your Bible app, and you can go with me to Luke 7, 1 through 9. And while you're going there, I want to remind everyone that we will be going over to the Victoria Manor in Temple Hills at 2 p.m. For our monthly worship experience with the seniors. And we want to invite anybody that would like to come. Come on over and join us at the Victoria Manor in Temple Hills at 2 p.m. I believe Reverend Rhonda Tuck is preaching today, and we can reimagine the way we got Sister Reverend Martin. We reimagining the way we're going to conduct the order of service over there. Hallelujah. 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 I love the Lord. Come on. He heard my cry. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. But I'm gonna say, and then before we pray, Sister Collins, when we're on the battlefield for the Lord, we're just trying to bring people into the Lord. We just ain't trying to make them AMEs. Hallelujah. It's good if they want to join the AME church, but when we go out, we have to adjust our order of service so everybody can understand. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, let's go. Let me read this scripture, Luke 7, 1 and 9. I have the New King James Version. The Bible says, "Now when he concluded all his sayings in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum. And a certain centurion servant who was dear to him was sick and ready to die. So when he heard about Jesus," I like this part, "he sent elders of the Jews to him, pleading with him to come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they begged him earnestly, saying that the one for whom he should do this was deserving, for he loves our nation and has built us a synagogue. Then Jesus went with them, and when he was already not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to him, saying to him, 'Lord, do not trouble yourself. for I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Therefore, I did not even think myself worthy to come to you. And here's what he said, but say the word, and my servant will be healed. But say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I am also a man placed under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to you, to one, go, and he goes. To another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him and turned around and said to the crowd that followed him, I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. And those who were sent returning to the house found the servant well, who had been sick. As we get ready this morning in a season of upgrade, and we're teaching from the sermon series, the spiritual principle of authority, and the sermon title is Understanding God's Authority, Part 3. Understanding God's Authority, Part 3. Pray with me as we get started. God, in the name of Jesus, move Gerald out of the way. Let the real teacher teach. Let the Holy Ghost do it. God, we thank you. God, we praise you. God, we lift you up. God, we ask you to do what you need to do. Save people, set people free, heal, deliver, let them grow, calm people, move people underneath your wings and underneath your authority. God, we thank you and we praise you. Do it right now in Jesus' name. Amen, 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 and amen, amen. Understanding God's Authority, Part 3. For all you military people, today is 9/11. Today is 9/11. And in 2001, we suffered the massacre and of 9/11. There was a plane that hit the Pentagon. Brother Evans, that a lot of the training took place at the small airport on Church Road in Bowie. We want to pray for those that are survivors, those that have family members that survived what happened in New York, the plane that went down in Pennsylvania, and the Pentagon. I have friends that were in the Pentagon at that time, and they have survived it. So we do want to continue to hold up them in prayer. But I want to say something about that, because when you're in the military, the orders, you don't necessarily see the person that gives the orders. Even at my level, when I was a second lieutenant, I had a platoon sergeant under me. And so I didn't always have to come out in front of the platoon and give the order. I gave the order to the platoon sergeant, and sometimes he went out and he said, this is what we're going to do. And so you don't necessarily have to see it. But staying under the order of God is God's plan to protect our lives. And so there is a perversion to that, Brother Evans, that Satan has really done. We can go with that on 9/11, because the hijackers of the plane, they got some orders from somewhere too. They were under some type of order. Hallelujah. But it wasn't a plan to protect lives. So I say there were not godly orders that they got. And so we were been looking that that authority is God's plan to protect our lives. And we talked about God put several plans in place. He organized the earth, he organized the world, and so to simplify, so man or humans can have a simplistic life. In other words, whatever was done in heaven, he wanted done on earth, and that's how he organized things to make things simple. And he put in sow and reap because we needed a provision to provide for our lives. So therefore, he put a plan for man to provide. So whatever you sow, you shall reap. And so God only intended that to be good. So because only good was happening in the heaven sphere. So he was intending that only to be good in the earth. And then stewardship, dress and keep in the garden. He said, I'll put you in the garden and dress and keep it. And now he put the plan of authority in to protect our lives. I don't know about you all, but when I grew up, authority, it did not necessarily, as I say, had to be present. So when I was in school, are the authority of my grandmother and my parents on how they told me how to act in school was present with me. And so you didn't necessarily have to be right there to post it or to say it. And this is where we come in our society today, Sister Dixon. We have, not us per se, but people have come out from under God's authority. The enemy has done a great job. He started, as we talked about in the Garden of Eden, and we talked about that point where it started, and God spoke to everybody, to man, and he said, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. In the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. And that was distorted, Brother Randall. That's all Satan does. He has no new games. He are the enemy or the serpent or whatever you want to acknowledge of that presence. But the principle of authority, God's authority, was set in the earth realm, and the enemy went to work to set his authority, just slightly distorted. You won't surely die. And God said, no, in that day that you eat, you shall surely die. And so we die from our relationship directly with God. And ever since he sent his son, Jesus Christ, because, you know, we tried everything to work our way back to him. But Jesus, to bring us back, man, our humans have been on a shuffle to get back under God's authority. Let me tell you a circumstance. I'm a supporter, and I'll tell her that, of our county executive. I'm a supporter of Angela Alsop Brooks. And so the government cannot do everything. And so I support her at least on her curfew, or the curfew, just something. It's just a start. But let me tell you what's the problem. One of the problems is we have come out from under authority, and so we have done like what Satan done. Everything we gonna question. We're gonna question it. Surely that won't do any good. Surely grandmama didn't mean that when she told me to go to school and do this. Surely I won't get a whipping if she doesn't know about it. Surely, see, all of those things. And so now we've grown up a generation of adults that don't know authority the way it used to be. God's authority, I'm talking about. I'm talking about God's authority. And because grandmama spoke, or mama really spoke, or when you left home, on God's authority. Spare the rod. I'm going to get in trouble here and spoil the child. I don't mean, but here's the key. There was something set in God's word that gave grandmama and mama the authority in the earth realm over those under them. And we respected it. We understood it. But somehow Satan has initiated a little bit more of what happened in the garden, Sister Dixon, where God stated the authority, and then everything looked appealing. And we went for the appealing. And now that's where we are. We have parents questioning whether they should parent. We have parents, grandparents saying, this is not fair. You can't do this. We have parents and grandparents now in this age and time questioning authority because they never understood authority themselves. That's why you can't bring corporal punishment back into school. You cannot. You can't bring corporal punishment, spanking, back into schools, Brother Evans, because who's going to do the spanking? The teacher that grew up outside of authority and never got spanked themselves? They don't even understand spanking. So we can't put that back. That's gone. And so that's how authority has shifted. And we wanted to look at that because God says, even though the world has shifted authority, I need you to stand. Stand where? Under my word. And when all else fails, stand. Because it's my authority that is over even human authority. It's my authority that's over the government. The government shall be upon my shoulder. That's what the scripture says. And when we get back to God's authority, Sister Collins, when we get back, Sister Peel, to underneath God's umbrella, that's where our protection is, our streets will begin to be protected again. Our children will begin to see a new life. We got to get back to the root of it. It'll never be solved by what the government can do. It's got to be solved at the base of it. This thing is spiritual. And so now you see how we got off from it and the importance of God's authority. The battle, Sister Dixon, is not against the curfew. The battle is never against young versus old. The battle is not that. That's the enemy's way of lulling the people to sleep. The battle is we have to put what God's word says back into the root of our hearts and then live it out. All of us. And that's where the battle is. And point number two, let's pick up Mark, the 10th chapter, the 35th through the 45th verse we were talking about. Let's define what God was kind of rolling through of authority. And then we may not get any further than that. But here it is, Mark 10, 35, 45. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him saying, "Teacher, we want you to do this for us, whatever we ask." And he said to them, "What do you want me to do for you?" Come on, Jesus. Then he said to them, grant us that we may sit one on your right hand, another on your left in your glory. But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you ask. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink and be baptized from the baptism that I'm baptized with?" They said to him, "We are able." So Jesus said to them, "You will indeed drink the cup that I drink. And with the baptism I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit on my right hand and on my left is not mine to give, for it is for those for whom it is prepared." And the verse 41, "And when the 10 heard it, they began to be greatly displeased with James and John. But Jesus called them to himself and said to them, 'You know that those who are considered rulers over Gentiles lord over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you. But whoever desires," here's the key, "to become great among you shall be your servant. And whoever of you desires to be first shall be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." Let's look at this authority. Authority in the Greek means the exercise of power, or exousia, I'll spell it, E-X-O-U-C-I-A. That means the exercise of power in the Greek, E-X-O-U-C-I-A. And the best plan that the disciples had at that moment was Jesus defined the God type authority in the earth, because Jesus was walking with them in his earthly ministry at that time. And so when we look at what happened, we want to go back and talk about verses 35 through 41. That's when they said, "Can I sit at your right and sit at your left?" And that's the wrong type of authority. That's the wrong type. I understand why they did it, because in those times, the place of honor was a seat on the right, and the second place of honor was a seat on the left. And so they asked for the most prestigious places in Jesus's administration. You see it all the time, Sister Dixon, when you go to conferences. You got somebody want to sit on the right of the bishop, and somebody want to sit on the left. Hallelujah. And so that's all right if you're going to show kingdom authority. It's all right to sit over there if you're showing kingdom authority. Verses 43 and 44, "I really tell you, the bigger your authority gets, the more people you have to serve." Look at verse 43. "Yet it shall not be so among you, but whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servants. Preachers, hallelujah. Lay leaders, hallelujah. Hallelujah. And verse 44 says, and whoever you desire to be first shall be slave of all. You pretty much are on your way to slavery when you get authority in the kingdom. You have to serve more people the more authority you have. That's it. That's it. In the good time, serving. In the rain, serving. Inside the building, serving. Outside the building, serving. When you don't feel like it, serving. On the telephone, calling and praying, serving. Texting and emailing, however we communicate today, serving. Serving is one of the things that you have to understand. That's under kingdom authority. And Jesus came, for the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. Hallelujah. And so therefore, I like the in my mind, Sister Dixon, when I first started pastoring, I didn't have no problem with it. I understood the Pastor's Aid Society, and I understood all of the other accoutrements or all them extra things that come with pastoring. I did. But what happens sometimes, Sister Collins, is that, and Sister Pat Matthews, if you're on, is that sometimes I think it works on some preachers' minds, and they forget they're supposed to be servants and not be served. They got to understand it's more than serving folks the sermon on Sunday. Hallelujah. And the communion on first Sunday. It's a constant state of service. And so the more people you have to serve, the more authority you have, the more people you're going to have to serve. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's why we have to reimagine church, Sister Ella, at this point, because at certain intervals, you have to reimagine it when churches begin to grow. You have to understand that you're going to have more people to serve. And so your goal is not to take the personal stuff out of ministry. It's that I got to serve more people. Hallelujah. So once you get to a certain number in church, everybody can't come to the altar for communion. But you got to figure out the best way to serve people so that they understand no matter where they drink of that cup or take of that wafer, that is the altar of God because you're still serving. And so those are the kinds of things that we're moving to. And look, when we get to this thing, I like Hemingway and I love Hemingway because real ministry is done for the benefit of those ministered to, never to the benefit of the minister. Whew. And so yesterday, the sneaker fest, the backpack giveaway, things that our missionary society do, things that a lay organization do, things that you do in other organizations when that's still ministry, that you're still ministering, scholarships you provide, that's still ministry. It's done for the benefit of those you're ministering to and not exactly for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so here we come down to this word we use, EXOCIA, or the exercise of power. It's Sister Pat. We are servants of the Lord. Come on, I love that one. I saw that in the chat. I'm going to use that at 10:30, Sister Pat. I'm going to tell them that you said it in the chat the first time. The second time, I'm going to say that I said it. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. But here we are. This word, I just want you to get this, and then we can pick up here in Romans 8 when we come back. Exousia, exercise of power. It means three things, and then we're going to close out of here. It means that permission is granted to have this type of power. Permission is granted. In other words, it's lawful and you have the right to exercise this power. Let me give it to you in human terms. It's like we can get mad at the police if we want to, but they have the right to give a ticket to us even if we don't deserve it. They have that right. Even if we wasn't speeding. Now we got the right to go contest it, but they can give it to you. Why? Because the system of this world has given them that right, Sister Ella, that they can just write us a ticket off just because they think we're speeding. And so they have been given permission. Hallelujah. Permission has been granted to them. So that's the exercise of power. That's what that word power meant, or authority here meant. And so look at this part, number two under this, the meaning of exousia is the power to enforce. So you have the permission granted. That's one part of the power. And the power to enforce. That means one's commands must be obeyed. One's commands must be obeyed. And so the judge in a court, Sister Collins, can give you a sentence of 10 years. And then the judge can die before the person ever even finishes the sentence. But you got to serve the sentence. Why? He had the power to enforce. He had the power to enforce. And just because the judge said he had the authority, so authority gives the power authority gives power to this, to enforce it. And so number three, so we have the permission is granted under this type of power, the exercise of power. And that's what we're talking about here, the power to influence. And number three, this type of power implies the proper use of. When we exercise the authority of this type of power, it's on behalf of another. So you're supposed to use it properly because the power comes on behalf of another. And so when we exercise the authority of God according to and get aligned up under his will, then permission has been granted. And so God granted the permission for Christ to come. And so he had that permission, Brother Evans, to come. He gave him the permission. And then when we line it all up on him, he gave him the power to enforce it when he was on earth. That's why Jesus says in John 14:14 to the disciples, you may ask me anything in what? In my name, and I will do it. How I can do it? Because permission's been granted by my Father. And when permission has been granted by my Father, I have the power to enforce it. And I'm going to imply it and properly use it. I'm trying to talk to somebody. Somebody needs a healing. Jesus had been given permission granted from the heavens by his Father that you have all power, that me and the Father, you and the Father are one. And then Jesus had the power to enforce it, Brother Evans. He had the power to speak it. He had the power to lay hands on it. He had the power to just call it out. Why? Because that power to enforce had been given to him. And then Jesus, because Jesus was kingdom-minded, he had the power to imply it properly. That's why he said, anything you ask in my name, I will do it. And I came by to tell him away, anything you ask in his name, he still has permission. He still has the power to do it. He still will imply it for proper use. And so we can go right to Holy Cross in our mind hospital right now. And we can say to Brother James Furr, we're not even in the building because the greater lives on the inside of us. And so we can go right now and say, be healed, be transformed in the name of Jesus. Be turned around in the name of Jesus. You shall walk again, even better than you walked before, in the name of Jesus. Why? Because that name is that name. It's something about that name. It's something about that name. That name has been granted permission. That name has been granted the power. That name, it will imply proper use. And when we come back next week, I'm going to show you how that power has been transferred to us. Why? Because that same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives on the inside of us. So I'm trying to tell somebody that you don't have to wait for him to come and crack the sky. No, walk right up in the room. touch your child and say, you shall succeed. You shall do better. You shall have long life. You shall walk right. You shall understand authority. Do that right now, because permission has been granted. Power to enforce. And we'll apply it right by the word of God. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. Next week, we'll come back and we'll talk about Romans 8. Read Romans 8. That same power lives on the inside of us. The authority that God gave Jesus is inside of us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, give him praise and give him glory. Hoshe Horabosa. I felt something at Holy Cross. Woo! That Brother Fur, whether he's at Holy Cross or the rehab, something moved inside of him. Hoshe Debosa. At this moment. Because we got the power. And we've been given permission. Hallelujah. So I'm saying whatever moved under right then. I felt Brother Fur, but I'm telling you, it'll move in your family. It'll move in my family. It'll move in your kinfolks. It'll move under your grandchildren. It'll move under your children. Hoshe Debosa. That same power. Line yourself under God's authority. And when we come out from it, get back up under it. And we have the permission. We have the power and we can enforce it. God, we thank you and we praise you. Do it right now in Jesus. Touch right now all those that need touching. It might not be just Brother Fur, but others need touching. Touch the family of Sister Maggie Williams and touch the friends and those that were close to her. Touch everybody at Hemingway. God, we thank you that we are a church that understands that that same power that resides on the inside, that resided with Jesus, now resides on the inside of us. God, we thank you now. And so let us walk with our heads up because we're making a difference in this world. At Hemingway, we're making a difference in lives of people that don't even know us. We're making a difference, Brother Evans, all up and down 210. We're making a difference wherever we live. So God, I thank you and I praise you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 If somebody just want to give their life to Christ. Oh, Shay. Want to turn it around. Put your name in the chat. Want to try and want to rededicate it. However you can hear this, put it in the chat. Or contact us by the ways on the screen. And if you need a church home, contact us. Come on and grow with us. Come on and help us reimagine how God wants us to do ministry after the pandemic. Everybody's in the reimagining stage, but I'm going to tap into God. I can't tap into everybody. I can tap into him. Come on and help us. Come on and help us. And by tapping into him, he'll send some folks and then he'll revitalize and use the people that we have to reimagine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you need prayer of any type, you don't understand about Holy Spirit, you don't understand how Jesus had the power and authority in his earthly ministry, whatever prayer you may need, you just might need a prayer for your family, come on and contact us. Hallelujah. For the screen. Come on. Let me tell you something here. Before I turn this over to the affirmation of faith and the closing of benediction and prayer, I want to tell somebody, God ain't counted you out. It's raining, and sometimes that take our stuff down. And yes, I sure will. Sister. Thank you, Sister Dixon. And so, yes. I want to say to you, God is counting you in. You thought you have been counted out, but he counted you in. You're still in the number. Hallelujah. You're still relevant. You still have a place. You still have work to do here at Hemingway. I'm talking to some people that thought it was over. I don't care how young you are and you don't understand it all. You have a place to learn, grow here at Hemingway. I don't care what other age we all are, wherever we are, you still have a place here at Hemingway to learn, to grow, to help us reimagine how ministry is to be done. Takes everybody. I don't have it all. You got some of it. I got some of it. The 10-year-old got some of it. The 80-year-old got some of it. The 75-year-old got some of it. The 50-year-old got some of it. All of us. I'm talking to somebody. God is calling us back together. Because God is going to use Hemingway, listen to me and listen to me closely, to be a prototype for the Christian world to see the goodness of him. We need everybody. We need everybody. You say little old Hemingway? Yes. Yes. God has to have some examples in the earth realm. Who's Jesus? Hallelujah. And he's going to use, he's using Hemingway. So we need everybody. God bless you. God bless you. I do want to pray on 9/11. And thank you, Sister Dixon, and Sister Dale Mercandale was in, she was in 9/11 at the Pentagon. And we thank you and we pray for her. And we pray, Sister Dale, if you're on, that God will continue to keep you. And God was your rescuer. And God was the one that brought you out. And God was the one that protects you. That's what authority. You were up under his authority then. And God had a plan of protection for your life. And he still does. And so God is still using you. And God still has a place for you in his kingdom, of course, and in his local church. And so I want to pray for how God brought you out. You're a member of Hemingway out of 9/11. And so, God, we thank you that that God, you helped bring her out and you protect her. And so we ask you to continue to protect her and her family. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, give God praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. The confirmation, affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. And in Jesus Christ's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead and ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of the God, Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Church Universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. God, what a wonderful time we've had in this service. Oh God, we just come right now at the end of this service just saying thank you, knowing it is the beginning of a beautiful time of learning what the pastor is giving, proclaimed to us in this morning. And we ask right now that you just push it deep down into our spirits, Father God, because we already have the power and we understand that servant leadership is where you're showing us to grow. We know that we must put this into action. We can no longer, Father God, say that we don't know or understand. Father, we ask right now that you just open up our ears, our hearts, our minds, and our spirits to receive how you make us move in this church called Hemingway. Father God, and we go out into this world to have them to understand that you are the leader and the guider, and that you will provide all that is needed. And if we just be the true servant leadership that you've called us to do, that you will be lifted up. And we will then say, Father, we will honor you. We will govern ourselves in how you will carry us, that the unsaved will say, what must I do to be saved? Father God, we thank you for this local body. We ask right now that you just restore our pastor, Father God. Fill him up for all that he has poured out into us. We ask right now that you just keep him and his family. Gird them up, guide them and direct them. Protect them, Father God. Build that hedge that will keep them and grow them. We thank you for Hemingway, Father, and we thank you for all that has been said and done. This is all in Jesus' name. We just love you and we adore you. Now on him that is able to keep us from falling and to the present and faultless just before him that you bring us, and to exceedingly joy, the only God, our Savior, the glory, the majesty, dominion, and power for now and forever. Let the church say amen.